Deeper Insights into the Illuminati Formula by Fritz Springmeier and Cisco Wheeler. Podcast 14. Chapter 6, Science Number 6, The Use of Electronics and Electricity. Continues. B4. Body Suits. Victims of mind control who receive implants often are given a body suit of implants. The location of these implant sites used on the human body have been mapped 10.00 out on the following charts. The mapped sites on these charts are verified by an insider, who learned from the inside what is going on, and this author's experience in working with a sizable number of implant victims. Implants can be placed anywhere, but there are certain key sites that tend to be used. The location used also depends upon the type of implant. Implants over the body create the ability to trigger moods, pain, and other phenomena. Implants for auditory sounds are in the ear. Nasal implants are used for mind control. Tracking implants are also placed into people. Section C. Specific implants. CL. Audio implants, A. Public, B. Secret. C2. Body manipulation implants. C3. Visual holographic implants. C4. Mimex/brain link implants. C5. Torture/nerve and muscle stimulation implants. C6. Tracking and ID implants. C1. Audio implants. Background information. The concepts used in audio implants had been discovered in the first half of the 20th century, but the refinement of technology to take advantage of what had been discovered waited until the second half of the century. The development of audio implants ran on two tracks: one was the public medical research and the other was the secret Illuminati/intelligence agency's research. Audio implants began to be publicly placed into people in the 1960s. The Illuminati was experimenting on some victims at this stage, and the military in the Vietnam War used auditory implant devices to aid communicating to their men who were sent into tunnels and who were placed into forest situations where audible noise would compromise their locations to the enemy. The Illuminati/intelligence/and military consortium was keeping the experimentation secret. It appears from looking at the worldwide research on audio implants that the Illuminati realized that the field was so ambiguous, and open to so many different approaches, that rather than straitjacket the research community by a specific strategy, they encouraged a wide variety of approaches in the research. Consequently, research by one group would overlap or duplicate research by another. Much to their credit, a few researchers rejected offers to get involved because they saw the sinister ramifications. By the 1970s, the intelligence agencies were willing to start using hundreds of people to experiment operationally with the implants. People in every state of the U.S. were selected as victims. Many of these implant victims had programmed multiple personalities already. The controllers were very heavy-handed with the people they implanted, and they used the full force of the Illuminati/intelligence agency's power to keep these people under their control at all times. These innocent victims have had their lives totally destroyed. Some tried to fight back, spending thousands of dollars to get out from underneath the incessant audio messages that the implants sent, but the system was too big and too powerful to fight. Police, congressmen, psychologists, and many other people turned their backs on these victims. Some victims who initially fought back gave up resisting, some committed suicide, and some continued to fight. Meanwhile, on the public track during the 1970s and 1980s, medical researchers kept putting more and more audio implants into deaf and hard-to-hear persons. Hundreds of people in the US and many hundreds in other nations such as the UK, Germany, Austria, Israel, Australia, France, and other countries began to receive the cochlear implants. Australia was so proud of their audio implant research/development they issued a postage stamp showing an implant device, Bionic Ear, developed in Australia. The question begs asking, if thousands of people have publicly received audio implants, isn't obvious that the secret societies and secret intelligence agencies have done at least as much if not far more? Brief chronology of audio implants. 1790 First known attempt by Volta to electrically stimulate the ears. He shot approximately 50 volts of electricity into his auditory system, and experienced the sensation of a blow to the head followed by a sound like the boiling of viscous liquid. 1850 Electro-osiatrics was begun by otologists who hoped electricity could help ear diseases in various ways. 1925 Sounds were created in people by radio engineers by placing electrodes near the ear with a modulated alternating current. 1930 Weaver and Bray discovered the principles used later in the cochlear microphonic implants. 1937 Bypassing an alternating electrical current in the audible frequency range from an electrode to the skin, Stephen, Jones, Lurie, and Flotterp found they could have people hear sounds. For a number of years these men studied this phenomena. 1957 Journeau and Iries in France woke the world up concerning the ability to electrical stimulate the auditory nerves and produce sound with their reports. A patient from France reportedly gets William F. House M.D. interested in developing an implant device. 1961 William House implants two patients with short-term audio implants. One patient receives a multiple electrode implant. 1960s Intense research for audio implants is conducted in California in places like Sanford, the University of California, in LA etc. The military uses audio implants operationally to be able to talk to soldiers in situations where external noise would compromise the location of the American soldiers, such as exploring tunnel system. 1970s Various researchers around the world begin publicly implanting audio implants into people. The Illuminati and intelligence agencies begin to secretly implant people. This is known because many of the early victims can pinpoint a time in the 1970s when they got their audio implants. 1980 The FDA establishes federal regulations regarding cochlear audio implants. 1984 By this year, 369 people have publicly received the House cochlear audio implants, which have been implanted by 36 different clinics. The 3M cochlear implant system. House designed for use in adults, which is already in hundreds of adults, receives FDA approval in November. 1990s Audio implants along with other implants begin to be used more aggressively by the mind control programmers. Successful intelligence operations are carried out with the aid of audio implants. Basics of how the implants can function. Thousands have publicly received audio implants, and thousands have received audio implants without their permission by the New World Order. The implants, whether secret or public, basically have to contain a receiver, S, B a processor, C a transmitter, D electrodes or electrical stimulating device. When sound waves arrive to the human ear, the sound causes biological reactions all along the auditory pathway from the cochlea, the auditory nerve, the brainstem nuclei and the primary cortical projection areas. Each of these areas are fair game for machinations of the mind control researchers. There are brainstem potentials which originate in the auditory brainstem nuclei primarily in the inferior colliculi. The public auditory implants produce a small electrical stimulus that bypasses damaged hair cells and directly stimulates the remaining auditory neural elements. This means that for the secret implants, the electrical impulse that is generated to stimulate the person to hear a sound or sentence is totally unnoticed by everyone but the victim. As mentioned before, psychologists are being used to shut victims up, by declaring that they are crazy for claiming to hear voices. How do these psychologists know that the person isn't hearing voices from an implant? Some psychologists are declaring the implant victims are crazy, delusional, and insane, because audio implants supposedly don't exist, therefore it is useless to give any credence to the complaints of victims. In other words, psychologists are being used as the establishment switch doctors to cover up the mind control activities of the New World Order. What's new? Establishment shrinks helped cover up the programmed multiplicity for decades by labeling the programmed multiple slaves paranoid schizophrenics. During experiments, it was discovered that the skin of a person can pick up auditory vibrations, so tests were run to see if implants in other parts of the human body could be used for auditory implants. The vibrotactical system of the skin has an upper limit of sensitivity to 400 to 500 Hz. In contrast, the auditory system had a frequency range between 20 to 20,000 Hz and an optimum range of 300 to 3,000 Hz. The auditory system had a dynamic range of 130 dB, which the vibrotactile had only a 30 to 35 dB range. In other words, using the skin like on the chest to send auditory vibrations to the brain was a very limited way to create sound. For most purposes, it isn't a viable approach, even though some experimental auditory implants were placed in places like the chest. The ones that were tested only reconfirmed the suspicions that the best results are by using the inner cochlea and the auditory canal area. Dr. Bijich's and later others showed that a nonlinear function will translate one frequency to another frequency, but although it does jump, this method is inadequate for the current mind control signals, and a linear function is used which operates simply on the energy that the implants have. Originally, single-channel devices were used, but then multi-channel devices were soon found superior. The processing units of a device had to have an extraction method to determine the pitch of the signal and then would present a square wave at the rate of that frequency. Soon the miniature computers that made up part of the audio implant were made so that they were programmable. Some of the publicly implanted people, for instance some who got a 4mm cochlear auditory implant, who thought they were getting medical help, were later followed up a decade later by the intelligence agencies for their own agenda, and instead of just hearing the world, they got to hear mind control drivel from some handler communicating via the implant. As sound waves come into the public implants, they are fast Fourier transformed into many channels lying between say 100 and 4000 Hz. Each channel may be assigned to a specific electrode located on an array of electrodes. The electrodes are stimulated, for instance, at 300 pulses per minute. The transmissions go to receiver/stimulators that then stimulate the subject to hear something. Fourier transforms have also been identified being used by human brains to encode memory. In order to keep their signals to their implanted victim secret, the network employs a tactic called piggybacking, where they piggyback their own audio transmission onto standard FM frequencies. CANAL is the acronym for an system that is used simultaneously for transmission and reception via the use of a double frequency shift keying, DFS. Radio transmitters that send quick signals are variously called burst, squirt, squash, or high-speed transmitters. Uses of the implants: A. By themselves, B. With other implants, and C. In conjunction with other mind control devices. Types of audio implants: Part A. Publicly admitted audio implants. Part B. Secretly implanted audio implants. Part A. Publicly admitted audio implants. The entire world has gotten involved in audio implant research. The British Cochlear Implant Group has been setting up implanting centers for the UK. Not all the publicly known implants will be listed here. For instance, some of those I chose not to list include some developed in Spain by Bosch and Kalamina, the ones created in Thailand by upgrading American-made implants, and several made in East and West Germany before the wall went down, and the Swiss implant, which was simply the Austrian audio implant used with their own processor. 3M Cochlear Implant System / House Design Model 7700, aka Alpha. Banffy, EMG. Several models developed by Banffy in Cologne Duren, West Germany. It is digital, with a pulsatile signal and a programmable memory. The implant can be communicated with using an interface device hooked to a computer. The patient has a keyboard. It was first implanted in 1977 and has 8 14ths and 16 channels. It has been implanted into hundreds of people. British, for instance, UK, developed by Duke, Forsen, and more in London and implanted with a single electrode in 1978 and multiple electrodes in 1990. The implant has bioglass and promontory grooves for the electrode, and neural network programming in its computer memory. Chen audio implant, developed in Guangzhou, mainland China, and first implanted in 1984. It was said by the Chinese that 20 people received this implant. Czechoslovakian implants were created by Volvoda and Tiki in Prague and implanted in the 1980s into a few people. Fraser developed in London, and first implanted in 1983. It was notable because it had a round window in the implant. In the first few years it was implanted into 56 people. They encapsulated the implant in a high-grade silastic rather than an epoxy, as some other European researchers had done. Fraser developed in Toulouse, France. This audio implant was implanted with its receiver in the chest. It was first implanted in 1981, and 22 people were said to have received it. Goa developed in Shanghai, China by Li and Lin. Inirade, FKA Symbian, produced by the Richards Company, USA. In the Journal of the Acoustical Society of America, March 1994, Volume 95, pages 1677-1678, they have an article about a woman who had an implant in one ear and not the other. She was asked to compare the pitch signals from natural sources versus the right ear audio implant. The most apical implanted electrode was not as accurate as the more basal located electrodes using an in-ear implant. ImplexCom 12 comes with an interfacing computer and a Syncom patient self-tester. Laura developed at Antwerp, Belgium. These were first implanted in 1986, and had an internal canal antenna, a microphone entirely internal in the auditory canal, a preamp, an antenna, and a data control circuit. Only a few subjects got this implant. It comes with a computer, and an interface unit. It does have a programmable memory. Med-L developed in Austria at Vienna and Innsbruck by Hockmeyer, and first implanted in 1977. Hundreds of people were implanted with this audio implant. Some were implanted externally with it and some internally inside the ear canal. It has one channel and a multitude of electrodes stimulating the audio channel. It is analog, and sends an analog signal. It does not have a programmable memory. MXM developed by Chouard in Paris and first implanted in 1974. It had been implanted by 1990 into 179 people. Nucleus 22, Nucleus Mini System 22, and other Nucleus audio implants, aka Clark's implants, dash at least two models developed in Australia at Melbourne. This audio implant was first implanted in 1978. The implant is programmable from the outside. It has been implanted into many hundreds of people. It has a multitude of electrodes that stimulate the audio system. It is digital, sends a pulsatile signal, and has a programmable memory. The implant comes with a diagnostic and programming interface computer. The Australian government heavily subsidized with millions of dollars research into audio implants and got the Cochlear Corporation, Nucleus, going. Nucleus uses what is called multi-peak, which provides high-frequency information from 2000 to 7000 Hz. With this, four electrodes are stimulated in rapid succession, and special algorithms are used which change the relationship between the pulse amplitude and the pulse duration in order to allow four pulses to occur within a single frame. The Nucleus Mini System 22 was approved by the FDA for implantation in both adults and children. Storz Instrument Co.'s implant developed at University of California, San Francisco. Part B. Secretly implanted audio implants. There were several profiles of people that were used in the World Order's selection of secret victims to implant. The following were criteria that they liked in the selection process: A. Vulnerable, such as single women; B. People who were already programmed with trauma-based mind control; C. Psychics, who had already told people they heard or saw things ordinary people don't; D. People, not highly regarded by society, such as minorities, criminals, street people, mentally insane, who would not be able to find a support system to help them fight the experimentation. They also did the audio implants into some of their own intelligence agents, apparently to some who were getting somewhat difficult to their superiors. Because of this type of profile, and some other things this author learned, it appears that the initial two decades were used more for experimentation and development than they were for actual operations. However, With more than 2 decades of experience, they are now fully operational. From watching their interaction, messages, with victims of audio implants, it is clear that they are not in the testing stage, but are fully operational, and have a full cadre of trained operatives, men and women, to staff the secret bases from which the monitor and broadcast signals to their slaves. The staff their bases with 3 shifts and the graveyard shift leaves approximate 6 a.m. In other words, from what we can tell, they are using standard shift times for the audio implant control staffs. Cochlear implants. There are cochlear implants for auditory control secretly implanted without permission. A rubber molding skin color covers the outer lining of the ear canal. There are tiny slits in this lining, which when pushed to the side would show the presence of coils and a plastic rod / wire embedded in the area. Sometimes burn marks occur on sides of face due to intense heat generated by implants, which is painful. Dental auditory implants. At least a dozen victims have complained that after their teeth were capped they began hearing voices. Other sources indicate that during the filing process implants are being put into people. This is the type of implant placed into Jay-Z Knight and left dormant for many years until they decided to activate her as New Age Guru. Ridge implants. These implants can produce theta waves and even voices. They are designed to suppress a particular type of thinking. The body may be sent into paralysis or given various stimulus-response stimuli in order to suppress certain thought patterns. If the slave begins to have certain thought patterns that threaten the programming and programming structures, these implants kick in to divert the person's mental activity to something else. C2. Body manipulating implants. The subject of body manipulating implants could have been placed in Chapter 8, however the desire was to keep all the information on implants together. Mankind has placed objects into the human body for thousands of years in the hope that it would produce some type of change. So the history of this type of implants is voluminous. Reader's Digest had an article about how to give to paraplegics the use of their arms and legs with implants. Implants are being placed into the human body to effect growth changes, to change hormone levels, such as to stop estrogen, to change DNA growth, to carry out behavior modification, etc. Several papers have recommended that sex offenders get implants. The Rambo chips that have been put into many men have been linked to some big crimes. In recent times, the following body manipulating implants have been written about. Crystalline corticosterone implants. These implants affect the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal, HPA, activity when there is stress or basal activity. It was placed into the medial prefrontal cortex, MPFC, to regulate the response to certain types of stress. Journal of Neuroscience, September 1993, Volume 13, pages 3839-3847. Norplante contraceptive implant placed into Hispanic and Black teenagers using the Mantle-Hensel procedure. Written about in Journal of Adolescent Health, May 1995, Volume 16, 5, pp. 389-395 by Nancy Campbell Hyder, John Glantz, Sandra Glantz, Eric Schaff, et al. Polymeric brain implant. These implants are ethylene vinyl acetate copolymer matrix discs and are used to release into the brain dopamine for a period of a number of weeks. The testing of this has been done at Yale University School of Medicine. Written about in the Annals of Neurology, April 1989, Volume 25, pages 35-356. Written by Matthew During, Andrew Fries, and Bernhard Sabel, and Mark Saltzman, et al. Proto 32 implant designed by Dr. McDaniels and a Dr. Paul Hodd. This implant with a 32-bit microchip memory affects DNA growth within a person. The two doctors who developed the device are claimed to have died after they created the chip. The FDA has approved the use of the implant in the brain. It's believed that there is a patent on the chip. Silastic melatonin-filled implant used to alter the speed of resynchronization of the circadian rhythm in birds, and implanted by the Max Planck Institute for Verhaltens Physiology, Andex, Germany. Although this was for birds, Mention of it is done here to point out the type of research done at the Max Planck Institute. It was written about in the Physiology and Behavior magazine, July 1995, volume 58, p. 89-90 by Michaela Howe and Eberhard Gwinner. Testosterone implant used to release testosterone into the subject. C3. Visual/holographic implants. Background. Hollywood has given us movies where visual and holographic implants are shown, but what about the real world? Yes, it does happen in more than the movies. Publicly, the establishment has only experimentally placed visual implants into a few volunteers. On the real-life side of the NWO, there have been a number of victims who have been subjected to visual implants without their consent. One victim in Massachusetts labels her visual implants visual prosthetics, but mentions I use this term loosely because they are more so attachments than replacements of my own vision. Every now and then the public is made aware of where the world order wants people to think research is at. In the January 13, 1997 issue of U.S. News & World Report, p. 52, the unveiling by researchers of the retinal chip that could potentially give sight to the blind was reported. It was interesting the article's choice of words retinal chip unveiled, bold added. After it was realized that sounds could be artificially made via electromagnetic waves in deaf people, researchers naturally thought of giving sight to the blind. In the 1960s and 1970s, researchers struggled to produce implants that could restore sight to the blind. This research was hijacked by the NWO types and has been developed into another component for their mind control. In the 60s, Giles Brindley and others at Cambridge University, and in the 70s, William Dobley and others at the University of Utah, both were able to show that individual fosfens could be evoked by electrical currents, thus showing the feasibility of visual implants. C.G.S. Brindley's paper, The Sensations Produced by Electrical Stimulation of the Visual Cortex in J. Physiology, Volume 196, 1968, pages 479-493, and W.H. Dobley's article in 1974, Fosfens Produced by Electrical Stimulation of Human Occipital Cortex, and Their Application to the Development of a Prosthesis for the Blind. In J. Physiol, 243, 553-576. The public development went forward with the blind. Since most blind people still have the neurons, which are like a natural computer, in the higher visual regions of the brain fully intact, the implants are designed to take advantage of this unused potential. The body has sensory pathways that were discovered to be maps. In creating a visual image, the brain actually takes an image through several maps before getting the final image. There is a map for motion, along with at least five others maps, such as one for form. The photoreceptors of the retina react to the three primary colors and have three primary color maps created by the electrical image made from the photoreceptors of the retina. One's genetics contribute to how each person perceives a primary color. We don't all see colors uniformly. The retina's output, called optic nerves or retinal output, map the electrical image again onto the retinal ganglion cells. Then the optic nerves project the electrical image to a relay image, the lateral geniculate nucleus, where the brain begins combining the maps of the two eyes. Another network of neurons, called the optic radiations, then transfers the image back to the rear of the brain to the primary visual cortex. Then the brain takes the image through several higher-level maps to its final finished product, the viewer's perceived picture. The microelectrode array that creates a map for the blind person may be hooked up to the primary visual cortex, or other points in the process. The microelectrode arrays that were initially tested were much cruder than the human eye. They pixelized, turned into pixels, that is points, what the video camera saw. The implant compared to the human eye's natural abilities something like what the old dot matrix printers created in comparison to a computer laser printer. The blind person's perception via the implants is somewhat cruder than actual sight. Experiments have found that the brain has a great deal of power in choosing how it interprets images, so that it is hoped that the plasticity of the visual system will allow blind people's brain to adapt to what they are being shown over a period of time to get the maximum visual advantage. This also implies that victims of visual implants which are of a more sophisticated technology will also have a natural tendency to rewire their brains to accommodate the new sensory inputs. One of several groups of public researchers into visual neuroprosthetics, visual implants, is Richard A. Norman, with the Department of Bioengineering, John Moran Lab for Applied Vision and Neural Sciences, at the University of Utah. In 1990, he spoke to people at the IEEE International Conference on Systems, Man, and Cybernetics about visual implants. At that conference on cybernetics, there were already well-thought-out methods for creating silicon-based electrode arrays. The Johns Hopkins University in Massachusetts is another research center into visual implants. MIT and Harvard have also been researching in the subject of visual implants. Advances in material available and microfabrication techniques has permitted the semiconductor manufacturer to create electrode arrays with 3D architectures, which can then be implanted into the visual parts of a person. How they work. In a true visual prosthetic, a video encoder, camera, transforms the visual world in front of a blind individual into electrical signals that are used to excite neurons at some point of the visual pathway. The video camera encoder will be a silicon retina that replaces some of the functions that the human retina performs, and then it makes what it sees into signal compatible with the neurons the encoder must stimulate. The signals from the encoder excite neurons either via a hardwired percutaneous connection, or a telemetry link. The stimulating electrodes must be implanted into visual pathways such that each electrode is able to excite only a small population of neurons in the vicinity of the electrode. Norman, Richard. Visual Neuroprosthetics Functional Vision for the Blind, in IEEE Engineering in Medicine and Biology, Jan Feb. 95, pg 77, to improve the picture sent by the implants to the brain, electrodes the size of the neurons they intend to stimulate in the eye were developed. Kensel Wise at the University of Michigan created small high-density electrode arrays out of silicon. In one model, the electrodes are 0.08 mm at their base, and taper to a sharpened tip. An array of hundreds of such electrodes can be implanted into cortical tissue about 1.5 to 2.0 mm below the cortical surface. This is not all of the design considerations involved, but it gives an idea of the direction that public research has gone in. A special pneumatic inserter that can shoot the arrays at high velocities to insert them into the cortical tissue was created by Patrick Rousk. This method provided limited cortical-based map images. To further improve the picture, implants are being created that create a retinal map, rather than a cortical map. This can take advantage of the image-forming properties of the human eye, and may give satisfactory images. At the current pace of public development, visual implants that restore sight are only a few years away from mass production. Meanwhile, the network continues to create and use visual implants that are more sophisticated than what the public sector has been allowed to create. Bear in mind that these researchers use either foundation grant money or government grant money to operate. The network is very careful about what technology is developed. Some excessively ambitious implant researchers, not visual, but other, have seen their work have a national security gag order thrown over them, and the research ends up muzzled from getting out to the public. Types. Fiber optics. Fiber optics permits the network to use a fiber optic that looks like a hair as a television camera. In a bodysuit, several fiber optic cameras that look like hairs will be installed in key places to provide the handler's remote viewing. Fiber optics can also be mounted in the victim, to provide a means to receive remote pictures. Fiber optic implants can be placed by needle into any site on the body. One victim of electronic mind control, who has repeatedly pulled out fiber optic hairs, had a tiny fiber optic hair shot into her chest above her tank top while she was in a restaurant. Some other implants that carry out the same function look like warts, moles, or blisters. Artificial lenses. One victim describes his eye implants. They are oblong objects with a square opening in the middle of them. They appear to be located on my corneas or wrapped around them to be more accurate. They are connected to rods or wires that are spread out over my facial area and under the skin like a mask. The implants also appear to be connected to cochlear implants, which are the cause of the repeated voice transmissions that I hear. Via a camera, she was able to pick up the presence of a reddish-orange smear or stain covering my eye lens. The color blends with her own eye coloring, so it is extremely difficult to see anything in her eyes. The lenses of the implants are not lined up evenly with her cornea. The victim with the visual implants states, "Whenever I close my eyes, I see the presence of constant red-orange haze centered with a tint of whitish-blue. I also see a small area of fluorescent green color. When I sleep, I am subjected to virtual reality-type pictures like programs being run through a computer with a 3D effect. There is a constant whirring and clicking effect that comes from other implants such as the ears." In review, visual implants are at time called visual prosthetis, but are actually attachments rather than replacements. They are oblong with a square opening in the middle of them. They are located on the cornea, wrapped around them, and are connected to rods/wires that are spread out over the facial area and under the skin like a mask. The coloring of the implant is blended with natural eye colors to camouflage it. When the victim closes his or her eyes, there is a constant presence of a red-orange haze centered around a small screen. There are also two orbs with a tint of whitish-blue, and a small area of fluorescent green. Visual reality pictures are run like programs from a computer, that have a 3D effect. The left forehead scalp area has a whirring noise. Biochips that talk to nerve cells. Some of the readers will have already heard of the biochips that talk to nerve cells. Stanford Research INST has been working on such biochips. Bear in mind, public research is generally a cover for what has already been discovered. Holographic or H insert. There is one type which has been called a holographic insert or H implant. A holographic memory is created by this implant. This may or may not be the nanobots which are capable of creating holographic images in the mind. Let's discuss the nanobots. Holographic implants via nanotechnology and nanobots. Nanotechnology is technology pertaining to very tiny robots and tiny computers that are in the range of nanometer size, 10 to 1,000 billionth of a meter. Nano means 1 billionth. In other words, extremely microscopic, we are talking about robots and machines 1 billionth of a meter large. The scanning tunneling microscope, STM, makes it possible to see something the size of a single atom. The STM will also pick up atoms and move them. People who are interested in nanotechnology have regular meetings in the Silicon Valley. A Johannesburg, South African company Nanotech, recently taken over by the American company Microchip Technology, was the company that created nanotechnology encoders, based on a nonlinear logarithm that mixes transmission lines and changes codes frequently. Microchip Technology is putting these encoders into their series of microcontrollers which are EEPROM-based. The encoders are called key lock hopping code technology. They are good in protecting microwave, ELF, infrared and radio wave transmissions. Microchip Corp is creating a sub-company group called Secure Data Products to work with this type of technology. In other words, the Alex system reported on in Volume 2 is being miniaturized. Another nanotechnology company is Nanosystems, which is working with the Janssen Pharmaceutica NY unit of Illuminati control Johnson & Johnson. We know numerous companies like the two mentioned above, who are working on nanotechnology. We also know that they are not going to tell us their trade secrets and what they have really developed. For instance, this author had a hearty laugh when he read the New York Times, November 19, 96 PGCL, article Feet of the Minuscule, Scientists Make Abacus with Carbon Molecules, Invention at Swiss Research Laboratory may be a step toward building faster computers, because the article is patently disinformation. According to the article, a Dr. James M. Gimzuski and colleagues discovered how to make tiny balls of 60 carbon atoms each. They call these balls buckyballs. They can move these balls via what they call a scanning tunneling device. A picture of the teeny tiny 60 atom balls was shown in the article. So what did they do with this ability? They built an abacus, yeah sure. Come on guys. If the reader understands computers, a computer at the most basic level is simply a base 2 number system. Anything that can consistently move or switch can be the basis for a computer. A computer is simply an enormous amount of on-off switches, where 0 can stand for off and 1 for on, etc. The article states, scientists at Switzerland have invented an ultra-miniature abacus in which spherical carbon molecules sliding along the microscopic copper groves act as the counting beads for performing arithmetic calculations. So they are using it for arithmetic, yeah sure. IBM reported that its scientists used the STM to move individual atoms so that they spelled IBM in atoms. If you believe that the ability to arrange individual atoms and tailor-build molecules was so that IBM scientists could spell IBM, then this book isn't for you. A more recent New York Times article, February 2, 97, p. 6, discusses how Xerox Corporation has created sensors the thickness of peach fuzz. These are called MEMS, microelectromechanical systems. The article states, MEMS are all about doing more with less, about being lean, mean, and next to invisible. The article is lean on facts. It does give a hint of the incredible power these little gadgets have when the writer launches into his propaganda tirade at the end of the article. Paradoxically, the fear that accompanies the fantasy of nanotechnology is not that the culture will be as stratified and fragmented as Victorian England, but that the new culture will be one that is unrecognizable to everyone alive today. That is true. This nanotechnology is taking us to the place that society will not be recognizable. The age of the future is planned to be the age of robots. Humans, if they are to survive, are to be robotic slaves for the illuminated elite. However, this is not paranoid fear as the New York Times writer implies, but it is the unfortunate reality humanity faces. Some people apparently are already experiencing it. One victim of mind control, whose father is military intelligence and whose family is part of the Illuminati, claims that he has been subjected to tiny robots called nanobots. These nanobots have been featured on TV, where they have been billed as an asset for surgeons. Reportedly, these tiny robots can work off of 10 to 100 kHz of beamed power. They have coil-shaped antennas, two little six-pointed wings to attach and move themselves with. These tiny boron carbon nanobots have all kinds of purposes. One use is for multitudes of these nanobots to be placed into a single victim's head, where they are programmed to migrate to certain programmed positions where they can suppress the optical signals to the brain and replace these signals with their own holographic images that can be externally transmitted to the nanobots or pre-programmed in. They are trying or have succeeded, depending upon who is talking about nanobots, in making self-replicating assemblers. In other words, they have built miniature robots that build other robots. Sounds like something the Japanese would do. Nanobot researchers talk about how great it will be to have tiny robots that are smaller than a red blood cell circulating in our blood, removing fat, bacteria, and viruses. Some sources. Recent articles on nanotechnology include, Electronic Times, December 7, 95, Electronics Weekly, November 29, 95, Electronic Engineering Times, November 27, 95, The LA Times, November 11, 94, December 21, 94, February 7, 96, February 20, 96, The New York Times, April 30, 94, November 19, 96, February 2, 97, The Wall St. Journal, May 12, 94, January 9, 96, February 26, 96. Eric Drexler wrote Engines of Creation, Anchor Press / Doubleday, 1986, a book about nanotechnology. Books that will provide more information on nanotechnology. Drexler, K. Eric and Peterson, Chris and Pergamut, Gale. Unbounding the Future, The Nanotechnology Revolution. Morrow, 1991. Hameroff, steward our ultimate computing, biomolecular consciousness and nanotechnology. Elsevier Science Pub, 1987. White House, D.J. and Coatta, K., eds. Nanotechnology, Proceedings of the Joint Forum/Erito Symposium held at Warwick University, 21-22 August 1990. Adam Hilger, 1991. C4. Mimex/Brain Link Implants. The public doesn't understand that programs showing research are typically rumination to hide what's already in use. On CyberLife, December 17, 96, a TV story was done on Dr. Ted Berger, a biological engineer, at U.S.ca, who is working on a microchip that will be a substitute for the hippocampus memory. The story stated that in 2 years a brain chip can be made that mimics the pattern of brain neurons so that it can be plugged in. The New World Order's computer satellite system allows a communication devices to be embedded within a victim, as well as be mimics devices that are linked to the natural brain to boast the brain's memory. In the Volume 2 book, The Alex, Amalgamated Logarithmic Encrypted Transmissions, system was described which allows the NWO to pulse codes on different frequencies in an erratic fashion that makes the transmissions hard to even spot. The Alex system is one component of their ability to secretly transmit orders and information to their slaves. When a slave receives a bodysuit of implants, one implant will be a central control implant that controls the bodysuit of implants and receives information from an external transmitting source. Some of the slaves have had their central controlling implant at the base of their skull. The concepts that Hollywood portrayed in the sci-fi movie Johnny Mnemonic, where an oligarchy, in league with big business and the crime syndicates, controls the world, and uses a human who has an implant that stores tremendous amounts of information, is sad to say not so far removed from what is already happening in secret. Interface devices. The biocybernetic researchers for the New World Order have working on a number of interface devices to interface, link, the human brain with computers. A number of devices have been created. There is even a biochip the size of a large organic molecule that works as a mimex implant. The idea of implants is difficult for some people to accept. I am in the possession of X-rays showing implants, of anechoic chamber readings showing that victims were receiving constant synthetic telemetry signals from outside transmitting sites, and a variety of other items showing evidence that this activity is going on. For instance, Professor Ingmar Wickbaum, MD of the University Hospital, University of California Medical Center, San Diego on 10/6/83 wrote a letter to whom it may concern that skull X-rays of Robert Naslund indicated implants at the base of the skull that are possibly some form of brain transmitters. Some of the victims I personally know have managed to extract fiber optic fibers from their bodies. Organic bioprocessors linked to viruses. One direction that the New World Order took was to develop biochips and bioprocessors, that is three-dimensional organic circuitry that functions as computers. The conductive velocities of these miniature organic computers, protein lattices, are at least 1 million times faster than nerve cells. The circuit power of a given size of miniature organic computers is at least 1 million times greater than the same size of brain matter. Molecular computers made of living matter can be grown from DNA templates of genetically engineered bacteria. Synthetic proteins have been developed which match what they want to make into mini computers. The end product is a bioprocessor, tiny computer, within a cell. These mini computers are specifically linked with viruses which migrate to specific parts of the body. Viruses are primarily nucleoproteins, some of the small ones are not even alive, and they don't even have metabolism. They do not have a metabolism to kill with an antibiotic. The neurotropic viruses migrate to the central nervous system, nerves, the dermatropic viruses migrate to the skin, the pneumotropic viruses go to the lungs, the viscerotropic go to the abdomen, and other viruses go to other sites in the body. Because many viruses will select what area of the body they will reside in, the New World Order can tailor, in tissue culture, their bioimplants, which consist of a virus plus a bioprocessor, so they can target where they will end up in the mind-controlled slave. Such an virus implant is also called a symbiote, because it lives off of the host, the mind-controlled slave's own body. These virus implants have life expectancies that are a number of years long. A number of these implants within the victim serve as spies in the camp, reporting detailed records of what the host's body is doing. Research into how to splice and dice genetic material and then recombine it has been going on for a number of decades, and is very sophisticated. There are a number of very technical books on how to do it, but only a reader familiar with the language of genetic research could decipher their techniques and abilities with miniature RNA and DNA pieces. Several genetic books/papers describe how viruses can get host genetic material or other genetic material, thus giving us a window on how they transfer the miniature computers made from DNA templates to the viruses. In the book Mechanics of DNA Replication and Recombination, Proceedings of a UCLA Symposium held in Keystone Co. April 3-9, 1983, edited by Nicholas R. Cozzarelli, of the Department of Molecular Biology Universal of CA, Berkeley, published in New York by Alan K. Liss Incorporated, one of the leaders in this field said on page 12, "I remain faithful to the conviction that anything a cell can do, a biochemist should be able to do. And yes, they have been replicating strands of RNA and DNA, creating whatever they want. The Illuminati have been using these computers in viruses implants at least since the 1990s. The implants are easy to insert into the victim's body, and the specific virus transport themselves and attach themselves where they are to go. The Illuminati then build body suits of these implants. The size of these tiny implants vary from tens of microns to hundreds of millimicrons. Just their tiny size makes them difficult to destroy. From research on victims, it appears that a central computer is implanted to control or interact with the body suit of implants. Psychics. One of the Illuminati's research projects was to discover the Psi gene, the genetic gene that would permit them to breed a master race with psychic abilities. One of the groups that the Illuminati has controlled which did research in this area was Nazi Germany. Mengele, in fact, was interested in the correlation of blood types to psychic abilities. Blood type B apparently has more psychics than other blood types. People who have true psychic abilities have a more complex molecular lattice structure than those who don't. They also have energy fields of 500 CPS or higher. This is in contrast with most brain activity, which lies in the 0 CPS to 100 CPS range. The heart operates at up to about 250 CPS, and the resonant frequency for a nerve is 360 CPS. In other words, the high CPS energy field is a tip-off that the person is psychic. A secret program has been carried out by the Illuminati to identify every person on the planet who is capable of being psychic. They are identified and then assigned to people, a male and female, to monitor the person. Psychics are often recruited into intelligence agencies to bring them under the power of the Illuminati's establishment. In other cases, they are simply watched and monitored, some who are threats to them are killed, and others receive mind control. They have been identifying people with psychic abilities and then trying to track and slash or control them. They also will try to recruit or place these people under mind control or both. C5. Torture / nerve and muscle stimulation implants. When a body suit is placed into a slave, implants are strategically placed in their body so that if they do not comply or if the network wants to make the person dissociative, they can direct the control implant to trigger these implants to activate. For instance, two implants will be placed on opposite side near the uterus and one in the lower back in order to give the handlers the ability to cause lots of lower back pain. Prior to electronically putting someone into an altered and controlled dissociative state, they will wear a person down with pain to make them dissociative. For instance, if an implant in the middle, square in the heel, of the foot goes off, a ball of electricity like a sparkler is activated, causing pain, anxiety, and discomfort. Some describe it as a hot pin prick in the foot. One victim and her mother both received these torture implants, and she was able to locate and remove some of them from her mother. I would like to paraphrase her description of finding these torture implants. I discovered fiber optic type implants on the lower back and also on the line where the leg and buttock join. The fiber optic sites on the lower back was one to the left of the spine, and consisted of two holes where the implants had been inserted, which were one above the other, and at a distance of 5/8 from each other. I was able to partially remove both of these fiber implants, but knots remained under the holes where tiny parts of the implants tenaciously remained. These two back implants seemed to connect signal-wise to the implant at the junction of the buttock and leg. This latter implant could create pain in the left leg and foot. Sometimes a crackling sound like crickets accompanies the signal to create pain. A vibrating electrical field is often used on victims of electronic control. Unconfirmed but possible. One victim described a device that could have a dial rotated to allow the sender to choose different types of signals to be sent. This would be pointed at a victim. As this sounds like a good possibility, it has been included here, although there is nothing to confirm such a piece of equipment, which is probably if it exists. Beldame torture implant, nothing available to report. Suicide implant, some claim that an implanted chip has been created that will release a poison upon a signal which will kill its host. This author has seen absolutely no evidence that such an implant exists. Its use is likely disinformation.